Good morning, everyone. I would first like to escort our faculty, C. Anjali Agarwal and C. Sonal Agarwal to the dais. C. Anjali Agarwal. She is currently a partner at Bansi S. Mehta & Company. It's a Mumbai-based firm and she heads the Delhi branch. She has cleared her exams in 2008 with an AIR 15. Apart from being a chartered accountant, she is also an LLB graduate. Her area of practice are mergers and acquisitions and corporate taxation. Our notable author too, and I request CA Hetri Shah to come and present the memento to the ma'am and welcome her. And I would also like to inform that CA Hetri Shah has come all over from Mumbai just to attend the conference with us in Ahmedabad. Ma'am, please take the charge.
Me for the introduction, members of the dais, seniors in profession, and my dear colleagues. Today we'll be having a session on issues of capital gains. As was rightly said, capital gain is one field where there are lots and lots of controversies, especially because capital gains is something which is not income as such, it is something which has become income because of certain specific provisions under the Act. So because of that, since it is not income, there are various controversies where income has been sought to be taxed as capital gains. This is what we will be seeing in our today's session. The synopsis of today's session would be, we will be starting with recent developments. Certain circulars and protocols have been brought into the field of capital gains in this year. So we'll just have a look on those recent developments. And then we'll have a discussion on certain issues regarding real estate sector capital gains issues. And then what are the tax implications at the time of reconstitution of a partnership firm? Corporate gifting, which is a very interesting way of, you know, avoiding, you can say, capital gains tax, go legal. So we will see what's the legality of a corporate gifting. And lastly, some day-to-day assessment issues in respect of capital gains. So let's start with recent developments. Okay. So first is business income versus capital gains. Friends, as you will know, as far as taxation of shares is concerned, it's been a long-prone issue as to whether the gains arising from sale of shares is capital gains or business income. Generally, because there are certain concessions where capital gains is concerned. For example, in case of listed shares, if it is a long-term capital gain, there is an exemption, or there is a concessional rate for short-term capital gains. SSEs generally tend to offer their income from sale of shares as capital gains. As against that, the income tax department always wants to treat it as business income. So it has always been a very long-run litigation between the two as to what is the nature. Because of this litigation, the CBDT have tried to come up with various guidelines, various principles to determine whether one shareholding is a stock in trade or a capital investment. So the first instructions had come in 1989, where they had laid down certain principles based on various decided case laws as to when a share can be regarded as an investment and when it can be regarded as a stock in trade. Then, subsequently in 2007, again it was further certain guidelines were issued. These guidelines basically were very subjective in nature, where they would say that you have to see the motive at the time when the shares were purchased, or how it has been treated in the books of accounts, or what is the source of funding. So these were the tests which were laid down. The first was treatment in the book of accounts. Second is, what is the method of valuation? As you know, for investments, there is a separate method of valuation, AS 13, and whereas in stock and trade, it is cost or NRE. So what is the treatment which the SSE is following? Then, what is the nature and quantum of the purchase and sales? Then, ratio between the purchase and sales, period of holding, the frequency with which the SSE trades in shares, motive, intention behind purchase of shares, then the source of acquisition, as I said, whether it is from borrowed funds or from personal funds, and certain other such principles. So if you will see these principles, they are very subjective in nature. How does one determine what is the motive at the time of purchase? A person may have purchased a share with the motive to have it for a long duration of time, but because of market conditions, because of maybe some personal reasons, they had to sell it off. So in these cases, even though the motive was to hold it for a period of time to acquire the share as an investment, however, there might be a short period of holding. So there is a conflicting condition which could happen in each case, especially in case of individual, it is very obvious because they don't even maintain books of accounts. So how do you see whether they have treated in the books of accounts as capital gains or as stock in trade? So because of this has always been a very big area of litigation. Due to this, last year a committee was set up under the chairmanship of Justice Eshwar, where one of the topics was on which the committee was to discuss was how to reduce litigation in this area. So this January 2016, they had come up with a recommendation on how to reduce the dispute in this area. So their recommendation was that wherever the SEC has offered the gain from sale of shares as stock in trade, as business income, then the AO has to accept it. He cannot go into litigation into it. Secondly, wherever the shares are held for more than a period of 12 months, if the SEC wants to offer it as stock in trade, fine. But if he is offering it as capital gains, then also the AO has to accept it. There he cannot deny you the capital gains by saying that it is stock in trade. Further, if it is held for less than 12 months, still they have put a limit of rupees 5 lakhs. So if your total gains is less than 5 lakhs, the AO still have to accept it as capital gains. Else they can decide whether it is capital gains or business income based on those guidelines which are already in place. Now the CBDT have partially accepted these recommendations. These recommendations were recommended to be made under the Act itself. However, that has not been done. They have come up with a circular. Within a month's time, they came up with a circular in respect of listed shares. So in listed shares, they have partially accepted these recommendations where they say that if listed shares are offered as business income, sale of gain from listed shares, the AO has to accept it. So these are the basic guidelines in the circular. That first, if it is offered as stock in trade, as business income, then the AO has to accept it. If the shares are held for more than 12 months period and the SEC wants to offer it as capital gains, again the AO has to accept it. Basically, it will become exempt. This circular applies only to listed shares. Okay. So, and then if it is held for less than 12 months, then the AO, then the litigation would continue. So this was in respect of listed shares. And in respect of unlisted shares, 2 months later, in the month of May, they again came up with another circular. There they have said, irrespective of the period of holding, if the shares are unlisted, then the capital gains are the gains arising from these shares will always be capital gains. So these two circulars have come with the intention to reduce dispute. This is mentioned in the circular itself. However, if you will see, it is a welcome amendment. In fact, though the circular has come only in May, there is already a tribunal decision of Jaipur Tribunal, where based on the circular, they have allowed the SEC's appeal, saying that since the SEC has always been offering it as capital gains, it should be accepted. So it is a welcome step from the CBDT. However, you will see certain controversies. First is, it says that where the SEC offers it as stock in trade, the AO has to accept it. So it leaves a place for misutilization of the circular where, say, a individual who does not maintain books of accounts has a listed share and he has sold it for a loss. So because of an exemption under Section 1038, because the gains are exempt, the loss would not otherwise be allowable. But if the SEC offers it as stock in trade, it would become a business loss and 1038 would not come into play and probably it would be allowable. And because of the circular, the AO would not even be able to change the treatment provided by the SEC. So there is a scope of probably misutilization the way it has been brought out. However, yes, it is a welcome amendment. Another thing, these guidelines which have been provided, they don't apply in three conditions. Where the assessing officer feels that these transactions which have been entered by the SEC are bogus, or he feels there is a need for lifting of the corporate veil in that transaction, or third, where along with the shares, the control and management of the company also has been transferred. So as far as bogus transactions are concerned, it's a right condition which has been provided, because they might be a bogus transaction and they might want to treat it like capital gains so as to avoid, take the exemption under 1038 and still avoid tax and then try to do something which is not actually happening. So there the assessing officer may go outside the purview of this circular and treat it as business income or maybe an unexplained investment. However, in case of lifting of corporate veil and in respect of control and management, that I don't understand how the AO can, avoid this circular. Now, as far as control and management is concerned, it is a settled law that when shares are acquired along with control and management, it has to be capital gains. When a control and management, where a shareholding control is acquired in a company, the SEC acquires a capital asset, and whenever there is a sale, there has to be capital gains. This was held right in 1961 by Supreme Court in Ramanarayan's case. In that case, the SEC had acquired managing agency by acquiring a majority shareholding in a company. So at that time, managing agency was a way of earning income, where it was a different concept at that time. So the assessing of what was the contention of the SEC that by acquiring the share, I have acquired a business of managing agency. So when I sell those shares, it is a business income which is coming out of it, and he had sold at a loss. So that loss should be allowed to me as business loss. So in that case, the Supreme Court had held against the SEC, saying that no, when shares are acquired with control and manager, it has to be a capital asset, and therefore it is a capital loss not allowable to you. So this is the second legal position. So now providing the assessing officer a right to treat it as capital gains or business income while when your shares are transferred along with control and management could be misutilized by the assessing officer, laying a bit, you know, a second legal position at this area. So this is, but otherwise it is a welcome amendment. So this is the first development which has happened in the field of capital gains in this year. Second is, as would be well known, the Indo-Mauritius GDAA has undergone a change. There is a protocol which has been entered into between India and Mauritius, where right now under the Indo-Mauritius GDAA, the taxation was based on source rule, residency rule. So if a Mauritius resident entity sold shares of Indian company, that was taxable only in Mauritius, was not taxable in India. This thing has always been looked at with a sore eye. As you know, the news reports always would report such transactions where a Mauritian entity has sold shares and how the tax department has tried to still bring it into taxation by treating it as a sham transaction or saying that they have arranged the transaction so as to take this benefit. So to do away with it now, today the government has entered into a protocol where the residency rule has been changed to source rule. As per this protocol, what it provides is that where shares now, where a Mauritian entity sells shares of an Indian entity, it would be taxable in India. However, it is only partially modified. What they have done is they have protected the existing investments in Mauritius. So if shares were acquired before 1st April 2017, if shares were acquired before that, and today also if a Mauritian entity sells those shares in India, it would not be taxable in India. So what is there, the structures of the multinational companies which are there presently, they don't have to really change it because it would not affect them. However, coming forward, whenever any investments come to India, they may not want to route it through Mauritius because now it will become taxable in India. However, again to cushion it and to provide it a gradual effect, they have given a concessionary period of 1st April 2017 to 31st March 2019. So, if you acquire share after 17, it is taxable in India. But if you sell it before 31st March 2019, you would be taxed only at half a rate of the applicable capital gain tax. So, say for short-term capital gains, it is 15% or 40% in case of foreign companies. They would be charged only 20% for that 2 years period. However, again, to apply that concessional rate, there is a limitation of benefit clause provided in the protocol, which has to be satisfied by the Mauritian entity. So, we'll come to that later. And if the shares are acquired 1st April 2017 and sold after 31st March 2019, it would be taxed normally as it is taxed in India. There would not be any benefit provided in the CDAA. So they have provided for gradual shifting from the residency rule to the source rule. Now let's just come to the limitation of benefit clause. Limitation of benefit clause is a standard clause which many CDAAs have, where they have, you know, capital gains tax exemption. Basically, a limitation of benefit clause is a clause where they say that the capital gains tax exemption would not be available to a Mauritian entity if it fails the main purpose test and bona fide business test. What does it mean? That the Mauritian entity was formed in Mauritius only for the purpose of taking the benefit of the DDW, or it does not have any business activity, and therefore, only for the purpose of taking the capital gains exemption, if it is entity has been formed in Mauritius, it will not be allowed the exemption. Because generally these multinationals come from USA, etc., and they have just a major company in Mauritius so that they can take the exemption. So this was not there earlier in Mauritius CDAA. Now they have provided it only for that 2 years period. After 31st March 2019, any which case it will be taxable in India. So it's a main purpose test and bona fide business test. For this, again, they have defined shell and conduit companies. What is a shell and conduit company? Again, the same thing, which is just an intermediary company without any business activity. There, they have provided for a monetary limit that if a Mauritian entity for the immediate 12 months preceding the date of transfer has less than 15 lakhs Mauritian rupees expenditure, it would be deemed to be a shell or conduit company. So the expenditure shows the substance of the company. If they have at least 15 lakhs of expenditure incurred in a 12-month period, it shows that they have some business activity going on, and therefore it is not a shell and conduit company. They are eligible for the tax exemption. Another, however, if they are listed on the Mauritian stock exchanges, then they will not be regarded as shell and conduit companies. So for limitation of benefit law, basically there are two parts. One is shell and conduit company. So if you have less than 15 lakhs of Mauritian dollars expenditure, you are a shell and conduit company. If you have more than that, you do not have. However, if you are a listed company, you will not be regarded as a shell and conduit company. However, even if you are not regarded as a shell and conduit company, you still have to satisfy bona fide and main purpose business test. So that was without being irrespective of whether you are a shell or conduit company or not. So that is for the purpose of those 2 years. Okay. Now let's just intricately examine this protocol. If you will see, this protocol refers only to shares. Shares and not securities. As you know, securities are defined in SECRA to include shares, debentures, stocks, derivatives, etc. So there are various investment mechanisms rather than just shares. So this residency to source whose base of taxation has been shifted only for shares. So this is going to affect mainly those multinational companies. As far as FIIs, etc. are concerned, if you will see, they won't be affected, but they have cushioned their effect. They invest in many other instruments rather than just shares. Further, shares, if they are held for more than 12 months, anyway, still they would be exempt even in India, in case of listed shares. And derivatives still here also, they have come up with an amendment under the Act itself, where they have specifically said that where FIIs are concerned, if they are holding derivatives, it will be capital asset for them. So again, not a business income. Because this exemption would otherwise not be available if it is treated as business income. That is another line of litigation. So FIIs have been as such protected, where shares are held for more than 12 months, it would be exempt. And other instruments other than shares are anyway still not taxable in India even after this protocol. Further, even for the companies, existing companies who have invested in India through shares, they can shift to other hybrid instruments like, you know, convertible debentures, etc. Because that would not fall within the definition of shares, and they can still take the exemption under the protocol. So this is a very limited, even though it appears to be a very big step, it is, but it is still limited to only shares. Another thing which is very interesting to note is the impact of this protocol on other EWAs. As you will know, Singapore has a similar exemption where if you are investing in India through Singapore, it is not taxable in India, it is taxable in Singapore. That was brought in the year 2005 by way of a protocol. In that protocol, there is one Article 6, which is coterminous with Mauritius. In that protocol, it has been mentioned that this exemption from capital gains in Singapore would be available only till the time it is available in the Indo-Mauritius UTW. So in not so many words, but since this has been changed, there would be an impact also on Singapore DWA. And these coming to detail, Singapore may also not be now eligible for the capital gains tax exemption in India. The issue is, how would, I mean, what is the extent of their, you know, how much would it not be available? In the same manner, in the phased manner, the way it is provided in Mauritius, or it would be outright, you know, not available. So there are some new reports that they are now in talks with the Singapore government. So probably we have to see, you know, how this is going to affect it. But surely there is a dicey area, and even investments coming to Singapore will have to have a look at what their structure is to see how this protocol is going to affect them. Okay. Now another thing is that yes, investments before 1st April 2017 have been protected. There is a specific LOE clause now in the Mauritius DWA which says that it will not apply to investments before 1st April 2017. It is only for that 2 years period. However, and if you will see the language in LOE clause is very similar to our GAAP provisions, you know, main purpose test, whether it is an impermissible avoidance agreement or not. The point is that though under the agreement between India and Mauritius, they have specifically decided that for these existing investments, LOB clause will not apply. However, there are still GAAP provisions applicable to them. So, even though the investment before 1st April 2017 would be exempt in India, there is always a chance of litigation by bringing in GAAP provision by the department, which is now to apply from fiscal year 18-19. I'll give you one example. In one case, Goldman Sachs case, there was an Indian subsidiary of a Mauritian company, and the Indian company had bought back its shares. So they had given money to the Mauritian company by way of buyback of shares. Now since shares of an Indian company are not taxable in India, they did not pay any capital gains tax, the Mauritian entity. The department did not like it. So what they said, that this is not buyback of shares, this is actually, you are trying to give them dividend, but you have structured it in by way of a buyback so that you don't have to pay DDT over it. So these are the kind of examples where, you know, the tax department tries to disregard the transactions with such entities so as to bring it into the area of taxation. Though in that case, the Mumbai tribunal had held in favor of the assessee, but that risk would still remain as far as Mauritian companies' existing investments are concerned. So this was another development which has happened in this year. Another small development which has happened is a circular rule 8. Okay, just a second. I'll just share with you the rate of capital gains which now will be applicable to Mauritius. In case of non-residents, long-term capital gains, as you all know, will be exempt, but short-term capital gains would be taxed now at the rate of 15% for listed shares. Now, as far as unlisted shares are concerned, the general rate is 10% for long-term, and for short-term, the rates differ, but for TDS purposes, generally, the rate is 30%, except for foreign companies, where the rate would be as high as 40%. Okay. Now, another small development which has happened is the insertion of new rule, Rule 8AA. If you will know that conversion of a debenture into shares is an exempt transaction under the Act. So if they are convertible debentures and shares are acquired on their conversion under 4710, it is not regarded as transfer. Further, under section 49 bracket 2A, the cost of acquisition of those debentures is assumed to be the cost of acquisition of the shares. But there was nothing in the Act on how is the period of holding of these new shares counted, whether it will be from the date when the new shares are allotted or it will include even the period of holding of the debentures. So there was a controversy on this issue. There are conflicting decisions. Punjab and Haryana High Court was in favor, where they said that since the scheme of the Act is to exempt this transaction, in the same fashion, even the period of holding should continue. However, Bombay and Calcutta had held in against. Their holding was based on this another explanation, 242A1F, which is actually applicable in case of bonus shares, where they say that when bonus shares are allotted in lieu of, you know, holding some shares, the bonus share period of holding will start only from the date of allotment. So they said that this is similar to that, where, you know, you are receiving new shares in place of holding some existing shares, and therefore the period of holding should start only from the date of allotment. So now this, there is a circular, a rule, which is putting not to this controversy, saying that the period of holding of the earlier convertible debentures, etc., would be counted. So it is a welcome rule. So these were the certain recent developments which have happened in this year. Of course, there are certain other which you would be knowing, the Finance Act they have provided, where 50C was amended to set not to the controversy that, you know, how will the stamp duty value be determined, either the date of agreement or date of registration of the agreement. So there were decisions on it, and now they have said date of agreement will be the date on which stamp duty will be determined. Another small amendment has been brought is in the definition of 242A short-term capital asset, where they are saying that in case of unlisted shares, instead of 3 years, now the period of holding will be 2 years in case of unlisted shares. So these were the amendments. Now let's take up another topic, that is certain issues on capital gains. Certain issues on capital gains on real estate. So as far as real estate is concerned, the biggest concern I would say today is development agreements. Development agreements are what? A landowner, he enters into an agreement with a builder where he agrees him to give the possession of the land. The builder constructs a building on it, and then when the builder starts selling, certain portion of the consideration comes even to the landowner, probably by way of sale of land or by way of constructed area, the ultimate collection. It depends upon the development agreement. So generally the assessee wants to pay tax on it, but at the ultimate point, when the actual sale of the constructed area happens, because that is the time when they get the cash in hand. However, the tax department does not like it. According to them, as soon as you enter into a development agreement, you should pay tax. Now, it creates a lot of hardship on the assessee because they don't have cash in their hands of that nature so as to pay capital gains tax on development agreement as on the date of agreement itself. So, this comes under basically 247(5). We'll go through it. So I have certain interesting points on it which could be used by an assessee so as to pay tax on the right time when they have actually money in their hands. So let's go through what is the law on development agreement. Okay. So capital gains tax is chargeable tax at the time of transfer. In case of development agreement, there could be two clauses. Transfer is defined under section 47. So there could be two clauses which could be applicable in case of transfer. But then one is clause 1, which talks about sale extinguishment of rights, and second is 247(5), which says any transaction involving allowing the possession of the inviolable property to be taken or retained In part, performance of a contract is the nature referred to in section 53A of TOPA, Transfer of Property Act. So, as far as clause 1 is concerned, there are Supreme Court decisions that when immovable properties are concerned, a transfer or sale happens only when a conveyance deed is signed and registered. Merely allowing possession does not amount to transfer. So, on that lines, a tax department cannot tax a development agreement at the stage of drafting and at the stage of execution of the agreement under 247(1). However, 247(5) says that when you allow possession in part performance of a contract, it would be regarded as transfer. So, in case of a development agreement, what generally happens is, since you are the owner, you give a POA to the builder, a power of attorney to the builder, so as to enter the property, demolish whatever is already there on the property and start a fresh construction. So, this power of attorney is a possession of limited right you give to the developer. So under 247(5) again, when you give the possession, it says that it amounts to transfer if it is in the nature of 53 of TOPA. So there is where the entire controversy lies as to when 247(5) can be triggered. To understand that, first we have to understand section 53A of TOPA, because it says in the nature referred to in 53A. So when the conditions of 53A are satisfied, only then it will be taxable under 247(5). Now 53A of TOPA is a section where it says it is basically a section to protect the transferee, in the sense that I have entered into an agreement with a landowner, I have paid my almost all my consideration or a substantial portion of it, I have been given possession, but the conveyance has not yet happened, and then the owner says, no, I want my property back, you take your money. And I would say, I have already paid it and I am in possession of it and I am not in a position to now give away. I mean, giving away immovable property may have other implications. So 53A protects the transferee, saying that where you have part possession of the property, you are willing to perform your part of the contract and the terms of the agreement are clear that, you know, when will the possession be given, etc. Then the transferee's right of possession or the property is protected. The owner cannot ask the property back. So that is basically what 53A is. The conditions under 53A are that there must be a contract in writing. So there should be a written contract. Second, the terms to consider the contract should be clearly ascertainable. So when is the possession being given, how much is the consideration, etc. should clearly come out from the agreement. Second, third, the possession should actually be given. Fourth, the transferee should have done something in furtherance of his contract and he should be willing to contract. So if you will see, there are various conditions for 53A section to apply. It's not just possession, which is mentioned in 247(5) that, you know, part possession given and it becomes transfer. So to understand 53, we have to understand these conditions. As far as the first three conditions are concerned, contract in writing, etc., that is generally satisfied. Where there is a development agreement, there is a written contract. However, two controversies are, when is the possession given and is the builder ready to perform his part of the contract? Is he willing to perform? So we'll take up the first condition, that is giving of possession. How do you determine that the possession is given? It is a factual point. So it generally falls on the terms of the contract, as I said earlier. So generally an agreement would say that, you know, when the developer has obtained the approval from the government on the building plan, etc., at that time I give you possession. Or probably it says that I give you possession by way of a power of attorney. So those facts have to be ascertained from the agreement as to when is the possession given. Is it either the date mentioned in the agreement or is it the date when the power of attorney is executed? In either case, that will be the exact date when the possession is given. Again, another thing to be noted is even part possession is covered. It's not necessary that entire possession should be given. The transfer and the transferee both may have possession. You give the possession by way of power of attorney where the builder has the right to construct, and the owner, he has the right to go and inspect what is the construction happening. So in that case also, it would be regarded as possession has already been given. So in this case, again, there are controversies as to, okay, fine, possession is given, or as per the agreement, possession is to be given. Then when is the transfer? The first decision on this was Chaturbhuj Dwarka by Bombay High Court, where it had taken an extreme view, saying that if the agreement says, if it is intended that the owner will give the possession, then the date of agreement itself is the date of transfer, not the date of possession. In that case, what had happened was that in 1994, the agreement was implemented. In 1995, part possession or a limited power of attorney was given and the substantial consideration was given by the builder to the owner. And in the next year, a ultimate power of attorney was given. So what the SEC contended was that in the year when the ultimate power of attorney has been given, that should be the date of transfer, because that is the year in which all the domain and control in the land has been transferred. The department was of the view when the earlier year, when limited power of attorney was given, that should be the year. The Bombay High Court went a step ahead and disregarded both these contentions and said it would be actually be the date of agreement itself. So that was one extreme decision which was rendered, where they said if it is part possession is allowed under the agreement, even if it is not given, the date of agreement will be the date of transfer. But that position has been subsequently diluted by other High Court decisions. For example, in Kerala High Court, Cochin Stock Exchange, it was held that if as per the agreement, the possession has to be given when the first installment is paid by the builder, then the year in which the first installment is paid will be the year of transfer. Similarly, in Karnataka High Court, it has been held that if there is a specific date mentioned that this will be the date on which the possession will be given, so the year in which that date falls will be the year. Likewise, in AP and Allahabad High Court. So the possession has been diluted, where now we have to factually determine when the possession is given. So that is the year of transfer. However, again, that is only just one condition. Even if possession is given, but if you can prove that the transferee or the builder has not performed or is not willing to perform his part of contract, still it cannot be transferred. So you have executed a power of attorney, the builder has the right, part possession as per 247 has been given, but if you show that the builder is not willing to perform his contract, for example, he has yet not obtained the government approval, which is crucial for building the building, you know, that plans have to be approved, building plans, or he's not yet started his construction, or the contract has gone into dispute. So in those cases, even if a power of attorney has been given, if the willingness to perform condition is not satisfied, it could still not be regarded as transfer. This has been held in various decisions. One is Punjab and Haryana High Court, others are tribunals. What they say is that willingness to perform does not just come out of the agreement. In the agreement, the builder agrees, but that does not mean that he is willing to perform. It should come out unconditionally and unqualified. From the facts, it should come out. In all these cases, the consideration to the owner was to be received by way of a part of the constructed area, not by way of cash. So when the construction itself has not started, or in some cases when the approval has not been taken, and these agreements generally provide for timelines, that, you know, in 2 years this will happen, that will happen, etc. And the builder has not, you know, adhered to it. As you know, real estate market has gone into boom. So they have stopped their construction, etc. So in all these scenarios, you have given the possession, but the builder has not yet done his work, so you cannot tax me. So these are the line of decision where they say even if you give the possession and willingness to perform is not satisfied, it's still not transferable. So there is another line to 247 type. Now this is very interesting. There has been a third condition now by way of amendment in section 53A. This is a bit less known, that in the year 2001, by way of this Registration and Other Related Laws Amendment Act 2001, Section 53A has been amended. Earlier, Section 53A said that the words were, the contract, though required to be registered, has not been registered. So it said that even if a contract or development agreement has not been registered and part possession has been given, the transferee will have the right to keep the possession under 53A. So registration was not required under 53A. That was basically the crux, that you have not registered and still the transferee's right are protected. But that law has been changed in 2001, where these words have been deleted. Simultaneously, in the Registration Act itself, in the registrable documents list, this has been added. Instrument which intends to provide, transfer the land in the nature provided in 53A is now required to be registered. It further says that under a suit before the court of law, if the document is not registered, the transferee cannot enforce his right under 53A. So you understand, 53A talks about protection of the transferee. Earlier there was no requirement that the contract should be registered. Now, if a contract is not registered, the transferee has no protection at all. He cannot go to the court under 53A to ask that, you know, that my possession be retained. This law has been subsequently, after this amendment, upheld by various courts, as I have listed down, Ramkrishnan versus Vijinder, etc., where they have said that after 53A amendment by this 2001 Act, if the document is not registered, the transferee cannot ask for the possession or the completion of the contract. So because of this, even 247.5, according to me, stands amended. This is because 247.5, the definition of transfer, refers to Section 53 of TOPA. Now under General Clauses Act, Section 81 says that Wherever an act refers to another provision of another act, and that another act gets reenacted or amended, then the general law is, unless an intention otherwise appears, that the re-amended or re-enacted law should be considered even for the interpretation of that written provision. In fact, in our income tax itself, Supreme Court has said that when there was an inclusion of a provision of another statute, it was held that a provision must be construed in the sense it bore in statute in which it was taken. So it says that it should not be just, you know, you refer to the section, it should be seen that whether that section is getting satisfied. So after this amendment, in my view, unless you have a registered development agreement, it cannot satisfy the conditions of 53A and therefore cannot be a transfer. That is, if you will know, generally development agreements are not registered. The registration happens only later. Because at that time it is the land conveyed. Registration of development agreement now is required, and actually the rates are smaller than, you know, the rates of conveyance. So if 5% is for your property, the registration for development agreement would be 2% less or something. And when you actually convey the land, you have to pay the balance amount. This is how generally it happens. But generally, probably the parties won't even enter into registration. So as far as development agreements are concerned, this could be a very good ground to argue that on the date of development agreement, there is no transfer. This has been held, it has been upheld in some sort by the Punjab and Haryana High Court in CS Agarwal's case. Okay. So these were the conditions based on which an argument could be placed that a development agreement is not taxable until you actually sell it. Now, even in this case, of course, there is litigation. So there are certain way outs out of it. How do you structure your transaction so that this controversy does not even apply to you? So the first way to structure your transaction of development agreement would be where instead of holding the land as a capital asset, the owner holds it as stock in trade. Now in stock in trade, definition of transfer 247(5) would not apply. Why? Because 247(5) says transfer in relation to capital asset means so and so and so. So it does not say transfer in general. So that definition will not apply in case of stock in trade. In case of stock in trade, what will be the date of transfer? Then you have to go back to the general law, as I said earlier. Supreme Court has held that in case of immovable property, transfer happens only when you have actually conveyed the property, the registration deed has been transferred where the conveyance happens. So when you hold a land as stock in trade, these controversies would be out of you. But of course, when you have income, you will have to operate as business income. Further, if you are already holding your land as capital asset, then to hold it as stock in trade, you will have to convert it. So in that case, there will be actually two tax implications. Till the date of conversion, under 45(2), there will be a deemed capital gains. So you will take the market value of your property as on the date of conversion. And the difference between that and your cost of acquisition will be your capital gains. And when you actually sell the property, the difference between that and the market value will be your business income. However, need not worry in the sense that this capital gains will not be taxable today. It will be also taxable only when you ultimately sell. 45(2) provides for that taxation, but the tax impact arises only when you ultimately sell the land. So at least that way, when you have cash in your hand, it is at that time when you will pay the tax. This again is supported by various decisions. The first one was R. Gopinath HUF, and then there have been various tribunal decisions. We have listed down that for your reference. That is one way in which you can avoid this controversy. The second way, in my opinion, would be not totally avoid it, but at least postpone it till the date you have actually, you know, when you are close to actually selling the constructed property. That would be by instead of entering into a development agreement, you enter into a joint venture agreement or say a partnership. There what you would agree would be, a owner would agree that he will contribute his land into the partnership form, but he subject to certain conditions, and when those conditions are satisfied, the firm will record that land in his books of accounts. So, as you know, in case of partnership firms, the capital gains tax in the hands of partner arises only at the value at which a capital asset is contributed is recorded in the books of the firm. So, if I as a partner contribute a capital asset instead of money into a firm, the value at which that asset is recorded in the books of the firm is deemed to be my true value of consideration under section 45(c). So, if an agreement is structured in this manner, where instead of forthwith contributing the land, you agree to enter into a AOP or a partnership firm, and you say that I will contribute, but I will contribute after you say construct at least 90% of your building. So, and you give a POA under the partnership agreement. So, what would happen is, first thing in a partnership, even if the tax department argues that 247(5) would apply here because you are giving POA to the builder, etc. First thing, in case of partnership firm, there cannot be any transfer as such. But there is a naming provision, 45(3), which says that when a partner contributes, it will be taxable as based on the value at which it is recorded. So you are not satisfying that condition itself, since you are not recording it in the books. You will record it only at on a later date when, say, a majority portion of the construction has happened. So that way, when you record, at that time capital gains tax arises, and at that time you also have cash, because at that time the partnership will start selling the constructed area, which will have cash and can give you share of profit or share of profit from the firm, and then you can pay tax. So this could be another way in which, this could be another way in which you can postpone this and avoid these controversies. In these two decisions, it has been held that when land is contributed into an AOP and the land is not recorded under the books of AOP, there would not be any tax implications under 247(5), because 45(3) applies. So this was about development agreement. Now again, in real estate sector, another major controversy relates to section 50C. 50C, as you know, it provides that where you sell a land and the value at which you sell it is less than its stamp duty value, then the stamp duty value would be regarded as the full value of consideration. The language used in 50C is when consideration is received or accrued on transfer of land or building, then and that consideration is less than the stamp duty value, then the stamp duty value will be deemed to be full value of consideration under for the purpose of section 48. So because of, and 50C being a deeming provision, it is taxing something which is not actually taxable, because it is taxing notional income. You have sold a land at X value. It is saying that Y is the stamp duty value. So Y minus X, that should also be your capital gains, which actually you may not have received the notional capital gains. So we need to see the interplay between 50C, how this notional capital gains affects other sections. So one is 45(3). As we had just discussed, in 45(3) what happens is that when a partner contributes a property into a partnership firm, the value by which it is recorded in the books of the partnership firm is deemed to be the full value of consideration. Now what happens where a partner is contributing land? Now in case of land, say I contribute land into a partnership firm and I record it at say 1 CR value. Its actual stamp duty value, you may say, is 1.5 CR. So which will apply? 45(3) is also a deeming kind of a provision where the value at which I have recorded it should be deemed to be my full value of consideration. 50C says that where the consideration is less than stamp duty value should be deemed to be my full value of consideration. So in case of these conflicting provisions, which provision would override? There is one Lucknow tribunal decision in Carlton case where they say that 50C is a specific provision and should override. But according to me, that is not the correct law. As you can see, that both 50C as well as 45(3) are specific provisions. 50C is specific in the context of land, and 45(3) is specific in the context of contribution into a partnership firm. So there are two specific provisions which would override each. There is one Bombay High Court decision where it says that this rule, that specific overrides general, is not a universal rule. It cannot be applied everywhere. It applies only where specific overrides general in the same field. When there are two fields, provisions dealing with two separate fields, at that time this principle cannot apply. So here also, there are two fields. 45(3) deals in different field where there is a contribution into a firm, and 50C deals with a different field. So in my view, when there are two separate fields, this principle itself fails, specific overrides general. Further, this Lucknow tribunal has not considered this point. So according to me, it may still be arguable that it is not that 50C will greatly apply. Then how do we determine which will apply? Now, according to me, under 50C, the language is that where the transfer is assessed or accessible to stamp duty, and then the stamp duty value has to be taken. So the question of comparing the stamp duty value with the actual consideration arises where the instrument of transfer is assessed to stamp duty or accessible. As you will be aware, there was a controversy earlier that earlier the language was only assessed. So the controversy was that where I have not registered, say I have entered into only an agreement to sell, I have not entered into a conveyance, since there has not been actual assessment of my stamp duty value because I have not registered my agreement to sell, 50C should not apply. So they amended the law and they introduced the word accessible. So now assessed or accessible. However, in case of partnership firm, Is even stamp duty accessible when a land is contributed into a partnership firm? We will discuss that later when we discuss the topic of reconstitution of partnership firm. But you will, briefly, a partnership firm under law is not regarded as a separate legal entity. As you know, it does not have a body corporate status. So considering that, there are various decisions in stamp duty law which says that when land or any property is contributed by a partner into a partnership firm, there is no requirement at all to enter into a conveyance deed. The transfer would be complete even without conveyance. In other words, the transfer is not accessible also. So it is arguable that the word assess and accessible used in 50C do not apply when a land is contributed by a partner in a partnership firm. These are supported by these decisions. Even if you will see when this accessible word was introduced, the explanatory memorandum, it said that the intention was to include transactions which are not registered with stamp duty valuation authority and executed through agreement to sell or power of authority. So the intention was to cover transactions which were otherwise accessible. Now in case of contributions, since it is not at all accessible, it is still arguable that 50C does not even apply to it. The second argument would be, Section 50C says where consideration is received or approved on transfer of an immovable property. Under 45(3), when I contribute land into a partnership firm, I do not receive any consideration. There is a deemed consideration under 45(3), the value at which it is recorded. So the first condition itself that when a consideration is received or approved has to be compared with stamp duty value. What have I received or approved? As such, nothing. 45(3) provides for a deemed consideration. So again, it is arguable that for the purpose of 53, my deemed consideration cannot be compared with stamp duty value. So that question itself goes away. So for those two reasons, according to me, in case of contribution of a land into a partnership firm, 45(3) would override 50C because of these grounds, not specific overrides general. So that is one controversy which is there under 50C. Another controversy is again in case of 50B and 50C which will override. 50B deals with slump sale. So under 50B, when you sell an undertaking with all its assets for a lump sum consideration, it provides for a compensation mechanism. Now take an example where there is a, say, slump exchange. I'm saying slump exchange because slump exchange is a slightly different from slump sale, and there are decisions, etc., which say that slump exchange is not acceptable to that. Okay? So say there is a slump exchange and I transfer my undertaking for lump sum consideration, and I'm transferring to, say, my wholly owned, not my wholly owned subsidiary, but to my subsidiary, and I'm not receiving the fair market value of the transfer. So in that case, as such, the entire consideration might be less than the stamp duty value of the land. So can then the tax department, you know, apply 50C in that case and say ki aapka consideration itna hai, but you know, under 50C you should be taxed at so much value. So there is a Supreme Court decision in the context of 50B where it says that when an undertaking is transferred, it is very different from its component assets. An undertaking would have several other things apart from the tangible assets in the undertaking. It would have various IPRs, goodwill at least, and other tangibles, manpower, etc. So how do you value that? So you cannot segregate an undertaking into its component assets, especially when the consideration determined for the transfer is by way of lump sum consideration. If in the agreement itself it is an itemized sale, then it's a different story. But you are transferring an undertaking as a composite for a lump sum consideration, you cannot determine what are the assets and how much is one consideration to other. So relying on this Supreme Court decision, since an undertaking is different from land and building, 50C refers to only two things, land or building. So 50C cannot apply where you are transferring a land in the form of an undertaking, not just the land. So you are transferring land along with its employees, some computers, other things in the business, then 50C should not apply. Second, as I said, when there is a lump sum consideration, how do we determine how much consideration is towards land, how much is towards other properties? So even if you say 50C is applicable, how do you determine the capital gains under 50C? You compare the stamp duty value with what value? The entire consideration, some portion of it, what portion of it? So the mechanism to compute capital gains also fails if you try to even apply 50C in case of slump transfers. So as has been held by Supreme Court in D.C. Srinivasa Shetty, where the computation mechanism fails, capital gains charge itself fails and therefore cannot be taxed. So for these two reasons, again, in my view, when 50B and 50C are put together against each other, 50B will override and accordingly, 50C deemed provisions would not attract. Okay. Now, another controversy is again 50C with 54F. Now, as I said, 50C provides taxes on notional gain. You have received X amount, stamp duty is Y amount, it says Y is your full value transfer. Now, under 54F, in case of individuals, etc., HUF, if I sell a long-term property and I invest it in another property, in that case, I am exempt from capital gains. Now, me as an SE, I sold my land at 1 CR. I invested 1 CR. Now, the assessing officer says that no, it is 1.2 CR. Did I get the other 0.2 CR? I did not get that. So, how do I invest that? How would I, you know, otherwise, if I had got 1.2, I would have invested 1.2 and paid the entire, you know, capital gains as exempt under 54F. But actually, this is notional capital gains. So, I am taxed under 50C and I am denied 54C exemption also, 54F exemption also in that case. So there were controversies on this issue as to how do you interpret these two sections together. Now 50C, as I said, it says full value consideration for the purposes of section 48. So it says 50C for the purpose of 48 is the computation of capital gains provision. And 50C is the deeming provision. So one line of argument is that since 50C applies only in the case of 48 and 54F, 54EC, etc. are a separate code in itself, for that purpose you cannot consider the full value of consideration as determined under 50C. So for the purpose of 54F, the full value of consideration would be the actual consideration which you have received. So there are certain line of decisions which say that if I have received 1 CR in my example and I have invested 1 CR, that even though the assessing officer has taxed me at 1.2 CR, I would be the entire capital gains would be still exempt under 54F. So there is a notional tax to you, but since you have complied with 54F by investing the entire 1 CR, it would be exempt. So these are actually two tribunal decisions of Jaipur Tribunal and Prakash Karnawat and Dhyan Chandra Batra. So that was one line of decisions which are there. On the same controversy, there is another line of decisions also. In that case, again the tax department on the same lines is arguing that 54, since 50C refers only to 48, not 54F, then in another example where say I sold for 1 CR, tax department is saying it is for 1.2 CR, and I had actually in the new house which I had built invested 1.3 CR from my own 1 CR from the same and 0.3 from somewhere else. So in that case, I was arguing that since I have invested any which case more than the 50C full of consideration along with 50F. And the tax department said no, since 50C refers to 48, and for the purpose of 54F, full value of consideration would not mean 50C full value of consideration. So you would be allowed capital gains exemption only to the extent of 1 CR. For the 0.3, any which case you have to tax even though you have paid 0.3 CR extra. So that was another line of controversy on this issue. There is a Karnataka High Court in favor where it says that if as long as the SSE has invested under 54F, it should be allowed. It says that when the capital gains assessed on notional basis under 50C, whatever amount is invested in the new residential house within the prescribed period, the entire amount invested should be allowed the benefit of deduction, irrespective of the fact that the funds have come from the sale actually or from your other funds. That does not matter. So they have taken a beneficial interpretation of 54, saying it's a beneficial provision allowing exemption. So even if there is a notional capital gains under 50C, if you have actually invested that amount, you should be allowed to 54F. So there are actually two controversial decisions on these. And these controversial decisions, if you will see, have not even referred to each other. These the Jaipur Tribunal decisions do not refer to this Karnataka High Court, and Karnataka High Court does not refer to Jaipur Tribunal. So we'll have to see how it goes forward. Okay. Now this one is a small topic, I think everyone would already be aware that, you know, 50C refers to land and building. So there has been controversies that what happens then when an SSE, instead of transferring land or building, transfers certain rights in land and building. So land has certain rights like tenancy rights, leasehold rights, or development rights. So in those cases, can the tax department invoke 50C? The general principle is that no. 50C is very specific, referring only to land and building. There are other provisions under the Act where immovable property has been referred to, not just land and building. Immovable property is defined to include land, buildings, certain rights attached to it, etc. Since 50C only refers to land and building, these rights attached to a land or a building cannot be brought under the scope of 50C. So as far as tenancy rights and leasehold rights are concerned, they are favorable decisions, all are favorable today, that we say that 50C cannot be applied. However, in case of development agreements, they are contrary decisions. See, in case of development rights in the land, who has the development rights in the land? The owner himself. As against that, in case of leasehold and tenancy rights, I am not the owner at all. There is ex-owner and A gets only a leasehold right from him, which are transferable, and therefore I am transferring. So in case of leasehold and tenancies, what happens is there is another owner. I just have some right on it. I am not the owner. But in development rights, along with I am the owner, in which I also have development rights. So because of this difference, in case of development rights, the decisions are against, where they say that if development rights Arif Akhtar Hussain is a Mumbai tribunal, which is against, and it says that when development rights are transferred, 50C would be applicable. There is one favorable decision also, but there the facts were slightly different. In that case, the owner of the land, there was an owner of the land, and the government had taken over the property for highway construction. So in place of the land, the government gave them some FSIs and TDRs. So in the another agreement, they sold that FSI and TDR. So there, he was no more the owner, he was only the owner of the development right on that land. So because of that, in that decision, they held that is not subject to 50C. But otherwise, the law is in case of tenancy and leasehold, 50C cannot apply, but in case of development rights, 50C will still apply. So this is in respect of real estate sector. Now, another topic which I have taken for today is reconstitution of partnership forms. The topic why I have taken this is because I find it very interesting. Recently, as I said, partnership firm is a very unique type of an entity. A partnership firm, against these companies and LLPs is an entity which does not have any legal status under the general law. Under Indian partnership firm is regarded only as a collective body of all the partners. Now, this is said in section 4, where it says that it is all partners collectively are known as a firm. And then it further says, then there are Supreme Court decisions referring to this section, and it says that a firm does not have a legal status. The assets held by the firm are actually assets of the partners. So legally, the position is when I have a firm, they are the partners, but I am the owner. Along with them, but I am the owner. In fact, as I said, there is not even a conveyance required. So if you contribute your land into a partnership firm, it will be actually held in your name, not in the name of the firm. As you know, even when partnership firms acquire shares in companies, the shares are named in the name of the partner, not in the name of the firm. So that is a legal law. But under the Act, partnership firm has a separate status. It is regarded as a separate person, it is taxed separately. So because of this interplay, the taxation at the time of admission and retirement of a partner, or at the time of reconstitution of the ownership of a partnership, is very different. It is very different from a company, where when shares are acquired or sold, it becomes taxable. That does not happen in case of a partnership firm. So we'll just discuss what are the tax implications at the time of an admission of partner or at the time of retirement, and see how what happens when a entire ownership of the partnership firm is reconstituted and still there is no capital gains tax. So let's start with admission. Now at the time of admission, okay fine. First thing, when admission, at the time of admission, the partner comes with cash. There cannot be any capital gains tax implications because he is not transferring anything. He is just investing cash in a partnership firm. He's getting some rights. So that is clear. But when a partnership firm comes in with the, when a partner comes in with a capital asset, what are the tax implications? There, as I said, the argument, since the legal law is that there is no difference between a partner and a partnership firm, the argument was earlier that there cannot be any transfer when a contribution happens, and therefore there should not be any capital gains tax. However, there the Supreme Court in Sunil Siddharth's case has held against the SEC and said that it amounts to transfer because individual right of a partner in a partnership firm has now become a collective right, and therefore there is some loss of right of a partner in the property, and therefore there is a transfer. In that case, however, they said how to determine the consideration, you cannot, and therefore there will not be any incidence. That has been subsequently revised by bringing in 45(3), which I said that the value at which it is recorded in the books of the partnership will become the full value of consideration. So as far as the incoming partner is concerned, I bring in cash, there is no capital gains tax. I bring in asset, and if that asset is recorded at the same value at which it was at my cost value, if I had acquired at 1 CR, it is recorded in the books of partnership firm also at 1 CR only, then it is again, there is no capital gains tax at the time of admission of a partner. What about the existing partners? When a partner admits into a partnership firm, the share of profit of the existing partners reduces. There were two partners 50-50, a third partner comes in, everybody becomes one third partner. So there is a reduction in share of profit. So can there be any capital gains tax implications in the hands of the existing partners at the time of admission of a partner? So firstly, on principles, since at the time a partner admits, he contributes, whatever he contributes, is it the partnership firm? The partners, existing partners do not receive anything. So on first principle, since there is no consideration at all, there should not be any capital gains tax implications. However, there have been various controversies, especially in case of land, where say there is a partnership firm and it has a land, and there were two partners, and further two more partners come in. And the existing partners, they withdraw the contribution which they had brought in by way of drawings or something. So in that case, tax department has argued that what the partner is essentially doing is transferring the value or the ownership of the land to the new partners, and therefore there is a transfer and there should be some capital gains tax implications in the hands of the existing partner. There, even though, you know, under law, these two, they are not regarded as two separate entities, for the purpose of Income Tax Act, the courts have held that a partner does not have a specific right over the assets, they have a collective right. So they cannot in specie transfer the assets of the firm to the new partner, and therefore, and there is no such mechanism under the Act, also specific mechanism, therefore there cannot be any capital gains tax liability even in the hands of the existing partners. So at the time of admission, the capital gains tax liability can arise only at one stage. That is where an asset is contributed and it is recorded at a value which is higher than the cost. Otherwise, there is no tax implication at the time of admission. These, whatever I have said, is supported by decisions I have referred to in my presentation. For example, Sunil Siddharth by 45C, and in case of existing partners, there is a Karnataka High Court in Panchwani's case and Kerala High Court in Kunnamkulam's case. Okay. Now, at the time of retirement, what happens? Fine. So now, a partner, there is a land and a partnership firm, two partners have come in. Okay. And now, after 2 years, say the existing partners retire. In the meantime, what happens is the partnership firm revalues its property. They determine what is the market value, they revalue their properties, and the amount, the revalued amount is credited to the capital accounts of the partners. So there is a revalued balance sheet of the partnership firm. After say a year or two, the existing partners retire. Okay? And what do they take? Nothing, but what is given is in the capital account. Whatever is the revalued figure, what is the balance in the capital account, that is all they take. So in that case, what is the capital gains tax implications? I have, as a partner, I have contributed, say, X amount. And after the revaluation, my figure is Y amount. So as far as I take Y amount back. So as far as X amount is concerned, what I had given and taken back, there is no issue. As far as Y minus X is concerned, whether there is any capital gains tax liability. So, because that is in the nature of goodwill, no? You're taking from the partnership firm. So one may say that, you know, when I retire, my right in the partnership firm is exhausted, is relinquished, and therefore, because of that, there is transfer and there should be some capital gains tax implications. But there, interestingly, if you will see, the courts have held unanimously that no, when a retirement happens, the partner is not relinquishing his rights or anything. What is happening is he is only receiving what is his own. It is a realization of a pre-existing right. They have, it's like they are compared with family arrangements and cases where, you know, a beneficiary in a trust receives what he has in a trust. In case of family arrangements also, they are decision where, you know, they are property in a family, and later on in a family arrangement it's like X property will be X persons, Y property will be B persons. So they say there is an exchange, etc. The courts have held no. Everybody had a cumulative right, now they are just realizing what is their own, so this is not transfer. So on the same lines, in case of retirement also, courts have held, Supreme Court has held in Mohan by Baba by case, that when a partner retires from the firm, there is no relinquishment of right on his part. He is just realizing what is his own. And therefore, there is no transfer. There cannot be any incidence of capital gains tax. There was one decision where, in Bombay High Court's case, HRS law, where they said there can be a capital gains tax implication. Because when a partner retires, he is giving the share of other partners is increasing. So he is giving away his share of profit to others. There is a transfer. But in that case, instead of the partner, instead of taking just the value which was there in his capital account, I had taken an ad hoc figure from the partnership. So there was no proper calculation of the goodwill based on the books of account. So that difference was realized, and in another subsequent decision, L. Ramkumar's Supreme Court, they have distinguished that Bombay High Court's decision and held that in that decision there was an ad hoc goodwill given to the partner, and therefore there it was held that there is capital gains. But when it is based on the books of accounts, there cannot be any capital gains tax implications in the hands of the retiring partner. That is two Supreme Courts, and then there is one Bombay High Court also, and then there are various decisions on this issue. So, on retirement, if as long as the partner takes only the value which is there in this capital account, based on the books of the accounts, even though he's receiving more than what he had originally contributed, there cannot be any capital gains tax implications in the hands of the retiring partner. Again, what are the tax implications in the hands of the partnership firm? So there, where cash is being given by the partnership firm to the retiring partner, there cannot be any tax implications because there is no transfer. Where land or any other property, when the retirement is happening by way of transfer of property, of course there will be a capital gains tax implications because of a specific provision under 45(4), which says that where there is a transfer at the time of dissolution or otherwise, then the market value of the property at the time of the transfer would be regarded as a full value of transfer. So there is one capital gains tax implication, but only where a property is transferred, not where only cash is transferred. In case where cash is given to the retiring partner, Karnataka High Court full bench has held that 45(4) cannot apply. So, at the time of retirement again, if you will see, there is no capital gains tax implications except when asset is transferred by the partnership firm to its partner. So, if you summarize the entire tax implication in case of firm together, you will see, as I said, in case of admission, no tax implications in case of incoming partner except for 45(3). And no tax implication at the time of retirement in the hands of the firm or retiring partner except for section 45(4). So in my example which I was giving you, you have a land in a firm. Two partners come in, they contribute money in a firm. The partnership firm acquires the land. Subsequently, two new partners come in by way of cash contribution. The books of the partnership firm is revalued and the value of the land, etc., the value of it comes in the capital account of each of the four partners, and after say a year or two, the existing partners retire. So in this case, legally if you will see, the ownership of the land has changed. Earlier A and D were the owners of the land, now C and D are the owners of the land. However, under the Income Tax Act, there will not be any capital gains tax implication. So that is a very interesting fact about a partnership firm. Now the question is, what about LLP? Limited Liability Partnerships is a body corporate under the LLP Act. However, under the partnership, under the Income Tax Act, it is given the status of same as firm. Firm is defined under 223 to include an LLP. So, can these all implications, you know, continue in case of an LLP? My view would be that that cannot happen because LLP, because the entire crux of these implications was that a partnership firm are two separate things. The question of realizing what is his own, etc., would apply only in that case. Now, since LLP is a body corporate, the share of a partner in a LLP may be more akin to a share of a shareholder in a company. So that is something which is still open, but in my view, probably these implications would not continue if you form an LLP. So this is another topic, reconstitution of partnership form. Now we'll take up corporate gifting. Corporate gifting as such, capital gains wise, the controversy is quite settled. In case there is a gift, 47(2) applies, which says that when there is a gift, it would not regard it as a transfer and therefore there cannot be any capital gains tax implications. In the hands of the recipient also, generally a gift is not taxable, it is regarded as a capital asset, capital receipt, except for the specific 56(2)(7)(7)(a) provisions. So generally what happens is that in cases of group restructurings or, you know, where the business houses restructure their internal shareholding and they try to, you know, streamline their shareholding in the company, many a time the transactions, the transactions happen by way of a gift, so that, you know, these implications, these 47(2) etc. provisions can be used by the assessee. So there, the tax departments have held, you know, they have seen it with a sore eye and they say that how can a company receive or give a gift? A company is an artificially juridical person. Gift should have a nature of element of, you know, love and affection. So in case of companies, how can a shareholder give something to a company or how can one company give something to the other company? So there they have tried to say that these transactions are bogus or, you know, not genuine and therefore these exemptions should not be given. There again, however, now the law has been settled because it says gift is not defined under the Act. It is defined under the Transfer of Property Act and in the Gift Act. And Gift Act has now been abolished, so we'll skip that. But in Transfer of Property Act, again, gift is defined. It says it is a transfer of an asset without consideration by a person. Person again in that act is defined to include a company. Therefore, based on these tax, etc. Courts have held in various decisions, there is a Karnataka High Court, Mumbai Tribunal, etc., which say that a gift by a company to another company, etc., is possible. It is not necessary that it should travel only between individuals. Accordingly, various transactions have happened between the corporates, etc., where shareholder gives its shares to a company, one company gives it to the other company, or you can say that a company gives it to a foreign company so as to avoid transfer pricing regulations as well, because it is not transfer, it is not chargeable tax in India. So this is one way in which even corporate gifting has now become permissible. Okay. So there were certain other things but, which I would have otherwise like to discuss, but I think I'm already running late. So I would like to sum up my session now. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Thank you so much.
Now I request CS Sonal Jain to please extend a vote of thanks.
Thank you so much, Anjali Agarwal ma'am, for sharing our valuable knowledge on various issues of capital gain, right from taking to the world of DTAA of Mauritius and Singapore, and also sharing knowledge of partnership reconstitution, development right, taxation of LLP, and I know the issues of capital gains are endless, so I request you that soon we'll arrange one more session for capital gain. Thank you so much.
Now, like before we move on to our next lucky draw of the day, one announcement here. We've had a personalized gifts for every one of us yesterday. So those who have not collected it, I request them to collect it from the outside desk for yourself as well as for your friends if they are not around. Chair for your office, home.